Yes, I haven't been in Colombia before, but I was invited by Professor Posada to come for a symposium that he organized here at this university. And that was on that was from Tuesday night through Thursday. I gave a presentation, an inaugural presentation on Tuesday night, and then I gave another presentation on Wednesday morning, and there were several other presentations in the symposium. And then I was asked to give today's presentation. So I was very glad to come and have an opportunity to visit Colombia. Well, when I was a student, I became both interested in social psychology and developmental psychology. I was interested in social matters, but I thought it'd be a good way to approach it by looking at it developmentally. And when I was in graduate school, I met Lawrence Kohlberg, who is a very well-known developmental psychologist who's working on moral development. His work followed up Piaget's work and started working with him, and I found his work very interesting and the whole field of morality and more generally the issue of morality in the world to be very interesting. So I've done a lot of work on that topic, as well as on other aspects of the development of social judgments. If I can tell you something more personal, I was born on a Greek island called Rhodes, and my mother was actually from Turkey, which is, were you here when I mentioned that I speak an ancient Spanish called Ladino? And that's why, because we lived in that part of the world, and this community had originally come from Spain, and they maintained their Spanish. But in answer to your question, because of my close knowledge of those particular communities, I was aware that there were problems of social inequalities that existed there, and which I think also exist in Colombia. And in some of those more, shall we say, rural areas or places where people live in villages and not necessarily in the cities, there's a good deal of patriarchy. So that made me very interested in studying these kinds of issues of inequalities and in those kinds of cultures, but it would apply to many places that I wasn't from, like Colombia or Japan or India. And so that made me very interested in doing this kind of work in these places. But I'm also interested more generally in how people deal with power differences. And you can have that even certainly in the United States, in parent-child relationships. So we've done some work looking at how adolescents think about those differences in control and power between parents and children. And we've done work where we've compared how they think about, for example, using deception with friends and using deception with parents. And for some situations, certainly not all, they think that it's more acceptable to use deception with parents than with their friends, because the relationship with the parent is not equal, while the relationship with friends is equal and mutual. Also in the United States, we've done research and looking at judgments about insofar as they exist, power differences between husbands and wives in marital relationships. There were several goals in our study, in our studies, and one was to see if in these traditional cultures or patriarchal cultures where we were doing research, if in fact people are not concerned with and don't think about independence, autonomy, freedoms of choice, because some psychologists and anthropologists say that they are not concerned with that. They're mainly concerned with interdependence. And I wanted to see if that was the case. I thought it was not, because my understanding of these cultures is that a good deal of freedom and of choice and independence is granted to males, especially in relationships with females. So that was one goal, but a more important goal for us was to look at how people think about power, control, and inequalities, and whether people who are not in the positions of power, again, the women in relation to men, if they are aware of this, of the inequalities, do they accept the inequalities, or do they judge them from a moral point of view and see them as unfair? And do they, even if they judge them as unfair, which we found they do, they're quite aware of the inequalities, they judge them as unfair, but do they just accept them? Accept the unfairness, and to some extent they do, but they also have to, because the consequences of defying the practices or those in power can be quite severe. But they also try to do something about it in whatever ways they can, sometimes in hidden ways or trying to persuade. And so we were interested in researching that part of it as well. So it was all these features that we wanted to look at. I've been very much influenced by the methods that Piaget used, and especially what he refers to as the clinical interview. And I've used that a great deal. And these are interviews in which the goal is to really be able to get information that tells us about how people, how children and older people are thinking about particular situations depending on what you're studying. And these interviews are structured. There are questions that are designed to get at particular issues that you're interested in addressing, but there's also the flexibility of probing and new questions to clarify things or to get deeper into the way the individual is thinking. So I've relied on that a great deal in many studies, including in studies in other countries. And I've not found that to be difficult, as long as you're sensitive to the differences in the other countries and how to pose the correct questions that fit the context. And then the other type of method that we've used a good deal, and that's important, is observational methods, where we observe social interactions, and this has been done in a variety of settings, including schools and playgrounds and even in family interactions, which are harder to observe. And we've done studies where we combine interviews with observations. So we observe events, in one study, one rather large study, we observed events in schools, in classrooms, in the playground, and at lunch, trying to capture events that fit into our categories of the moral and the conventional. And then we interview children right after the events have occurred, so that we can get at how they think about their own experiences. So those are the two main methods that we've used. We don't use so much qualitative analyses in the way that other researchers do. Our form of qualitative is also quantitative, which is that, for example, when we ask questions and get about, is this right or wrong to evaluate an act, we also get the justifications, why. And we analyze those in a sense in a qualitative way, but then we turn it into a quantitative analysis. Okay, so it's a combination of. Well, I don't know. Now, let me just mention, without minimizing the problems in Colombia, that gaming the system is not particular to Colombia. And a lot of people think that many in Wall Street game the system. Right? And maybe a different kind of corruption, but that they take advantage of people to make a lot of money that the big firms there do. So I think this is a general problem in economic systems and capitalistic systems. And you have particular problems here, and I understand it. It relates to violence as well. And I'm not sure how it affects people's morality. And I imagine that people who are studying moral development here, I can think of a few, would probably be better able to answer your question because they really know the situation here. But I don't think that it simply has an influence of these, that people just don't care about morality. I think they do, but they also care about their livelihoods. I assume there's a good deal of poverty in the country, and they want to deal with poverty. And it's easy, I think, for people to exploit other people in a situation like that. I find it a little hard to explain and understand, because what's happened in the United States, and we've become much more aware of it in recent years, is that the levels of inequality over the past 50 years have increased tremendously. And things were moving in the other direction in the 1960s and 1970s towards greater equality. There were concerns with poverty. President Lyndon Johnson in the 1960s had what he called the War on Poverty. And other politicians as well as other people were trying to do something about poverty and inequality. And we had social programs to try to help with that, Head Start, Medicare, and educational efforts, and things were moving towards greater inequality. And somehow in the past 30 years or so, it's changed. Now, I'm not sure this is appropriate or relevant to what you're asking, because it's getting into politics. But I do think that people like Ronald Reagan, who was president in the 80s, had a lot to do with that, because they pushed and forced systems that focused on the higher classes doing better and not giving to the lower classes. And I think they were, unfortunately, from my point of view, successful in producing much greater inequality. But I don't have and maybe some economists or political scientists could explain it better than I could. I don't have a good sense, but I know it's occurring. And there's some of the things that I mentioned about attitudes towards people who are wealthier and people who are poorer that have changed. And in the United States, for some politicians, we now have what we call the Tea Party, which you may be familiar with. It's going in an even more extreme direction towards inequality. Well, there are two areas of research that I'm very involved with, two general issues of current concern. One has to do with what we've been talking about, which is research on social inequalities, how people deal with power differences and status differences. And I'm continuing that whole line of research. I also want to get into research that looks more, that research looked at how people react to inequalities and how they try to deal with them and change them. But I now want to get into research that looks more deeply about how people think about the whole issue of equality and inequality, and where they think equality is important and where it may be necessary to have inequalities even though they value equality. And the other area of research that I've been doing and want to continue doing is on the development of moral judgments. We have done the research on the domains, which mainly shows that these different ways of thinking exist at young ages, and that the differences continue across ages into adulthood. But for moral reasoning, for moral judgments, we're just starting to really try to figure out what happens developmentally with age. We have descriptions from Kohlberg, for example, on development across ages, but those I don't think are accurate because of the way they fail to account for these domain distinctions. So we want to look at that, at development within the domain of moral.